Can I start the meeting? Can I welcome everyone to the Justice Committee's sixth meeting of 2016? Can I ask everyone to switch off mobile phones and other electronic devices that interfere with broadcasting? Everyone been switched to silent. I have apologies from Margaret McDougall. I'm going to ask the committee if I can move to item 9, which is Armed Forces UK Legislation Bill, and whether we can discuss this in private.
Agree.
You agree. We now move into private session. That's the committee back into public session, and I now move to item two in the agenda, Commission on Women Offenders. It's our main item of business today, and it's our annual evidence session on the progress and implementing the Commission on Women Offenders recommendations. I welcome the meeting Michael Matheson, Cabinet Secretary for Justice, Colin McConnell, Chief Executive, Scottish Prison Service, and Kerry Morgan, Community Justice Division, Scottish Government. Now go straight to questions from members. Alison, please.
Very much. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Panel. I'm interested to read the update on the progress that has been made over the last year on the issues relating to women offenders. At the heart of it was a service redesign, particularly round about community justice centres and things. I'd be grateful for an update from the Cabinet Secretary on what progress there has been. Of course, there was a divergence from the actual recommendation in the report, which was that we would roll out similar types across the country. I think the government has decided to have very localised, locally responsive centres. Could you perhaps give the committee more information on that?
Sure. You're correct to say that what we allowed was a level of flexibility so that local partners could design the service in what they thought would best reflect the local need. All in, there were 12 different projects taken forward. Some of them went down the idea of a justice centre type route, so the Tomorrow's Women Centre in Glasgow was that type of approach which they chose to take. In areas such as Forth Valley, they chose to take a different approach where they redesigned the services which they were delivering, but again with the same intention of working with women to divert them from the prison system as well. What has happened is over the last year is there's been an evaluation of those projects, and the evaluation has come back and demonstrated that in a range of them they have been effective in helping to reduce the need for women to go into the custodial estate, and also to help to support women when they are coming out of the custodial environment as well, and to support women who may be on remand in the community. That evaluation was published in the autumn of last year, which highlights the progress that's been made in these different project areas. Our intention is to continue to work with some of those partners over the months and years ahead and how they continue to develop the delivery of those services at a local level. So it's fair to say that we didn't go down the route of everyone having to have a justice centre. It was to allow local partners to design what they felt best reflected their particular circumstances. And for rural areas, a justice centre might not be the most appropriate route. A more bespoke approach was allowed in these areas to take forward a model they thought was appropriate.
Okay, and are you comfortable that, you know, I accept the need for flexibility, that there is a consistency of service available across Scotland?
I think it would probably be going too far to say there's a consistency of service. I'd like to see greater consistency of service, but I don't think we're there yet. Part of that redesign is also about changing community justice provision in Scotland, and the Community Justice Bill is about seeking to achieve that. And one of the ways which we can help to achieve greater consistency is through the creation of Community Justice Scotland, which will have that national overview of what's happening at a localised level in community justice provision, and also to drive improvements in those areas. While at the same time allowing a flexible approach within the local area that reflects local needs and local circumstances, but collectively helping to achieve a greater consistency. So I wouldn't go as far as saying that we have a consistency at this stage, but I think we are making progress in order to try and get to that particular point while also reflecting local circumstances.
Could I turn to alternatives to remand?
Can I just let somebody else in and let you back in? And because I've got a bit of a queue. I've got Gil, then I've got Margaret at the moment. Gil?
Thanks very much, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, I want to talk about electronic tagging. And I wonder if I can ask you how extensively electronic tagging has been used to date for female offenders and whether it has proved to be an effective remedy in enabling women to maintain family relationships, particularly with their children.
On female offending specifically, the use of electronic tagging for them, well, If I can give you some statistics, if that maybe just to put it in context, if that'd be helpful. During 2015, we had 1,806 restriction of liberty orders, which involved electronic tagging. Of those, 86% were for males, and 14% were for females. Now, those coming out of prison where they had home detention curfew imposed, there were 1,426 cases of home detention curfew license where electronic tagging was used. And in that instance, 89% of these were for males and 11% were for females. Now, I suspect the question you've got or maybe that that looks quite a low number for women compared to men. However,
Cabinet Secretary, it's a dangerous place to go.
I've known you too long, Christine. However, in terms of proportion of the actual prison population, our female prison population is around 4.5% to 4.7% of our overall prison population. However, about 15% of the electronic tagging takes place with women. So proportionally, it's actually much higher than it is for the male prison population. Just to put that into context, it would be fair to say that compliance with them has been broadly fairly good, with broad similarities between males and females, slight differences, but not significant differences. In terms of electronic monitoring, the compliance rate in 2015 was over 82% for women, and it was around 85% for males. So males are slightly more compliant by about 2 or 3%, but not by a great margin. Given it, the proportion again of women who are receiving electronic tagging is greater. In terms of specifics around helping to keep women closer to their families, there's no doubt that the use of electronic monitoring can help to support and assist that type of area. I'm not aware of any specific research, though, that's been conducted into the use of electronic monitoring and helping to maintain family relationships, but I think instinctively you would say, well, if someone's been given a tag and they're been given a home detention curfew and they still have their family there, then that clearly is helping to maintain those family links. But you'll also be aware we've got some detailed work being undertaken at the present moment on the use of electronic monitoring, and the expert advisory group are due to report in the next couple of months with their findings from that. It'd be fair to say, though, electronic monitoring is probably, I think international evidence would show, electronic monitoring is most effective when it's used alongside a range of other measures. Not just electronic monitoring itself, but other measures which are about trying to help to address some of the underlying causes that may drive offending behaviour and address some family issues as well. And the expert advisory group are looking at that type of issue at the present moment.
My kind of general interest, Minister, and maybe the government would look at these issues or these stats and look at, we know that particularly for women, that family relationships do break down, husbands and partners go AWOL and children go into care and things like that. So I wondered if you would be looking at the impact, if, you know, I think the thought process is that there's benefit for particular children and, you know, that they're looked after better by their mums and with support. So will you be doing some research into that and coming up with some figures in that regard?
Well, at the present moment, we don't have planned any research specifically on the use of electronic monitoring and family links aspect, but the work which the expert advisory group is looking at is not only our experience here in Scotland, but also international experience. Last year, I think it may have been the autumn of last year, we hosted an event in Perth where we had one of the leading experts in the area of electronic monitoring over from the Netherlands. He's a judge in the Netherlands, and they've designed a very sophisticated system in the Netherlands and how to make better use of electronic monitoring in helping to drive better outcomes in addressing offending behaviour. And they've put a lot of very detailed work into developing a model that he presented to us, which was which I attended, which was very, very interesting in itself. And that was organised by the expert advisory group, and that's the sort of things that they are looking at in advising and how we move forward with electronic monitoring in the future in Scotland. You know, I think it'd be fair to say there is more we can get out of electronic monitoring, but what we need to do is to make sure that it also has the right safeguards in place. So, you know, one of the things that I'm often asked about is why we're not using GPS much more. Well, there are technical issues about GPS. So, for example, it's been highlighted there are technical ways in which individuals can get around it. So rather than just simply... I won't, but rather than actually just say, well, yeah, let's just use more of it. That's the sort of thing that the expert advisory group are looking at to before we decide on what further areas we can use it within.
Yeah, thanks. And my last question, in the same vein, is I noticed that you had recently consulted in regards to reoffending, and for women that are in custodial in prison, that there's a 60% reoffending rate, so that's a high number. And I wondered if we're looking at the numbers in regards to when we're using electronic tagging, etc., if that's got an impact, if that steadies the ship and folk don't or women don't reoffend, if is that another tool? Has that been looked at?
I think this goes back to the point I was making earlier, is that international evidence would suggest that electronic monitoring is one part of the jigsaw that can be used in helping to work with individuals in addressing their offending behaviour. So experience would suggest that trying to use electronic monitoring just simply on its own is not an effective tool to simply address offending behaviour. It should be seen as part of a package of measures which are taken forward in addressing better or trying to obtain better outcomes. And that's exactly the sort of experience I've had in places like the Netherlands, where they use it in a much more sophisticated way. And I've got no doubt the evidence from there, actually, once the expert group have published a report, would be of real interest to the committee. Because they effectively have a system where the judge decides on what outcome he's trying to achieve, and they've developed a system that actually then demonstrates how you can use electronic monitoring in order to achieve that outcome. So it's a much more outcome-focused approach that they have to it. And I think evidence would suggest internationally that's the most effective way in which to use it, and the expert advisory group are looking specifically at that type of issue so that we can understand how we can make better use of it, but make use of it in a way which helps to achieve the better outcomes that we would all be looking for.
I think I was a bit careless in my question to you, and I'm really glad that you're actually focusing in on support in this regard and not just electronic tagging. Thanks very much.
I think the committee is well aware, as many years of experience in this Parliament, that many of these women are damaged, so it's heartening to look at the outcomes. So electronic tagging isn't just seen a way of not having people incarcerated, but it's a way of ensuring they have support systems to get off their drug, alcohol, mental health issues, all kinds of complexities which make it. And so can I just take it from that how are our judiciary looking at this now? Are they moving, well, not really for you to speak for the judiciary, but to comment on whether our judiciary are kind of working in that cultural change of what am I trying to achieve here with this woman offender, given that you've got the Community Justice Bill coming through that's, you know, trying to be more integrated and so on for support?
I think it'd be fair to say yes. I think there have been changes in the way in which the judiciary look at some of the issues around alternatives to custody. And you're right in that, you know, electronic monitoring, it should be seen as being, can it help us in addressing these other issues and prevent the need for someone to go to custody when it would necessarily be the most effective route to deal with these issues? And I think there's a body of work for us still to do there in understanding that. And you may be aware of some of a couple of pathway projects which were started in three sheriffdoms. This goes back. This is something, some baggage I brought with me from my time in health, and it's the youth. It's not a bad thing.
A lot of this is health issues.
It's around the whole the idea of using improvement methodologies to help to affect change and improve the way in which the system it responds to what it's trying to achieve. This is a methodology that underpinned the patient safety programme that we have extensively through our NHS in Scotland. And we've established three pathway projects in three sheriffdoms, which are very specific in using this new or using improvement methodology to look at. For example, if we want to reduce demand for the number of individuals who go into remand, then if we want to reduce that, say by 10 or 20%, what do we need to do in order to achieve that particular objective? And what the improvement methodology is and the improvement team are helping these particular teams that have now been established to do is to strip back the system and think, well, what do we now need to put in place in order to achieve that particular objective? And to then look at what changes need to be put in place that achieve those outcomes as well. So, and the sheriff principals, the three sheriff principals that agreed to participate in this can see the potential value in this. And we've now got a team of leads within the, which includes the Judicial Institute as well, who have an oversight responsibility in taking forward these three particular pathfinders using this new approach, which, as I say, is completely new to the criminal justice system. But it's an approach which I think could lend itself to driving some of the change that we need to see in the system, which is much more outcome-focused rather than process-driven. And that's what the improvement methodology can assist and support us in trying to achieve.
I think, in fairness to sheriffs, many of them don't want to see people coming up before them time and time again, because they can also see if we keep the same way the system fails, and that, you know, the route that the Cabinet Secretary is taking with the outcomes and presumed training for sheriffs will be better for the individuals in society at the end of the day.
Yeah, I think that's a shared objective.
Yeah. I've got Margaret, Elaine, and then John, then Alison back in again. So Margaret, Elaine, John, then Alison. Margaret, please.
Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Although it's early days, I wonder if you're in a position to provide any information about the uptake of fiscal work orders since they were rolled out to the 32 local authorities in April last year, and also about the number that are being successfully completed.
You're correct to say it is actually early days around the fiscal work orders. They come into play as of the 1st of April last year, which were available, which again were one of the key recommendations that the Commission had highlighted. They're available to both men and women in the cases where the fiscals think it is appropriate. When a new disposal is introduced, experience would often tell you is that it takes time for it to bed in and to become established. So for the for fiscals to get used to it and to understand it effectively in its implementation. So what we have saw is we've saw a gradual increase over the last year, less than a year now. We've still, it will be in the criminal justice social work statistics for 2015-16 that we'll get the first full cohort of fiscal work orders taking place. But the figures we have, the returns we have for June to November of last year may provide you with some insight into the numbers. So the number of fiscal work orders which were assessed during that reported period were 393, and the rest of the statistics will start to come through as we move forward on that. And of course, that's a statistical bulletin which is publicly available and will be available to committee members.
On a gender basis, you know, there has been an issue in the past about community service officers not being friendly for women, and for various reasons they default on them, and then the next stage is imprisonment by default almost. So
the guidance that was issued in advance of the fiscal work orders coming into play did set out some guidance around gender issues. So for example, taking into account that certain types of activities might not be appropriate, that it may be that certain groups should be female only, for women offenders only, that timings could also take account of if they do have childcare issues as well. So there is guidance there for some specific gender-based issues to be taken into account when fiscals are looking at making a work order. So there's a level of flexibility in the system to take account of these matters.
Indication of the types of offences that it would be deemed appropriate to consider a fiscal work order?
We haven't specified that to fiscals. These are largely for minor offences, but we haven't specified to them what type of offences that should be, and it's for a matter for them to use their judgement based on the nature of the offence and also where they then believe it's in the public interest for it to be pursued through the courts, or where they believe that a fiscal work order is appropriate. So we haven't defined it by a type of offence to give them the flexibility they need in considering matters.
Is Cabinet Secretary to start telling the Crown Office anything like that?
That's very true. If I get into a situation where I started specifying them here, then fiscals would then feel potentially obliged as though that's what the government's intentions were. So we've given them the guidance, set out very clearly for them and how they should apply fiscal work orders, but we haven't specified the types of offences that it should be used for.
Any information coming forward on where they have been set out for what kind of offences that's been? I think you said 393.
I don't know whether the criminal justice social work statistics will have it broken down by offence, but we can check that for you. But I can't off the top of my head remember whether it is broken down by offence.
Okay, thank you.
Could perhaps have that writing to the committee. Thank you very much. Elaine, then John, please.
Thank you, Convener. Mr McConnell, I attended a regional meeting sometime last year, actually, when we were developing the new model. And at that time, you had a presentation and you gave some indication of when you would hope that the new model would be in place. I just wondered if you were able to give the committee any sort of update on when the new facility at Corton Vale will be fully functional, and also when the five other regional centres might be.
I mean, thanks very much for the question. There's no doubt you would expect. I mean, we're working hard on this. The current plan that we have approved with the Cabinet Secretary and the Government would see us running a programme right through until final completion in 2021, which would not only anticipate the new national unit coming to fruition, but all the other elements that the Cabinet Secretary laid out to Parliament earlier. Of course, the Cabinet Secretary and the Government rely on me and the Prison Service, along with justice policy colleagues, to deliver on these things. And I can certainly give this committee an assurance that we are on track to do that as we currently speak.
Obviously, some of the plans, there will be fewer places, and therefore you're requiring a reduction in the female prison population. Have you done any modelling around that, and when parts of the current Corton Vale prison might be able to be decommissioned or reconfigured? Well,
of course. I think rather than sort of focus in on a number or a date, I think it's important to sort of engage with the committee really what we're doing here. Now, this is such, I think, a creative and innovative approach. I mean, if you look across internationally, nowhere else is doing this, nowhere else has achieved this. So Scotland is in the lead. Scotland's at the front edge of developing integrated, consistent services for women who come into contact with the justice system. So there's quite a bit of modelling going on, but as ever, you know, to fail to plan is to plan to fail. So there is modelling going on. There's lots of considerations and lots of discussions going on, but that's still a wee bit to go yet before we finally settle on a particular approach and configuration. As was previously set out, of course, in the public domain, it's only right that as we develop this new approach, we keep some flexibility in the system just to make sure that we don't break it as we're trying to make it. So as we move forward, just to reassure the committee, we are absolutely on track and consistent with what the Cabinet Secretary set out to Parliament last year. But in doing so, we'll be really cautious and really careful that we move forward on a basis that we can cope with any challenge that we might get along the way.
Could I also maybe ask about the
Before
work...
Before you move on,
sorry.
Alison would like a supplementary about the estate itself.
Thank
yes.
You. Thank you. Do you think you're being ambitious enough in regard to that planning?
In terms of the planning, I can speak for the planning. It might be for others to speak to the ambition. But I think, again, what we need to keep reminding ourselves is actually just how innovative Scotland is being. You know, we have looked across internationally for an off-the-shelf solution. There is no such thing. In fact, with the Scottish Government's support and leadership, as you know, last year, we held an international symposium on women in custody and just what the future should hold. And we got international recognition and support for the direction of travel that Scotland's moving in. In fact, I remember an expert from Canada saying at the end of the symposium that she wished she was working in Scotland, given her ambition. So are we ambitious enough? Oh, for sure. Is what we're doing creative and innovative? For sure. But I think, as head of the prison service, I've got to make sure on our government's behalf that as we move that ambition forward, we can actually deliver on the ambition. And that's why the care and attention to detail is being put in as we move the whole concept forward to achieve that ambition.
It seems to me that we need to push this a bit further. We've got currently around, middle of July last year, we had the number of women in custody was 414. The capacity that you're building for in this new estate is 397. That's not really the kind of reduction that I'd hoped that we would be building for.
Can I clarify that, Kerry?
Yes, actually, it's up to between you and the Cabinet Secretary.
Yep, if you
yes.
want
Colin,
to.
Yes, Colin
actually,
McConnell, please.
Actually, it's far more ambitious than that, Ms. McInnes. If you look at what actually is contained in the proposal, we're being hugely ambitious, because what the model would have at the end of this journey is a national centre at Cornet Vale of 80, five country regional units of 20, and of course the facility at Grampian. So if we do the math, this is at the end of the journey, if we do the math, then that's 80 plus 100 plus 50. Now that's...
So Edinburgh and Greenock, you're not putting in the
next... At some point in the future, and again, if you look at what we've put out as a discourse, we are on a journey, and part of my job is to advise the government on making sure that we can cope in capacity terms and stress terms as we move towards that eventual model. But as things happen, we've got capacity in the system that we can use. But ultimately, the challenge is to operate a system that has a national of 80, five regional units, and Grampian. Now, that is, to go back to your original challenge, hugely ambitious, and we must make sure that everything else that we're doing balances with that. So we will need some flexibility in the system.
Perhaps, if you don't mind, Convener, if the Cabinet Secretary can give us some assurances round about the decommissioning of Edinburgh and Greenock, some sort of timetabling for that or ambition to move towards that.
See, this is part of the challenge. And can I just go back to the ambition that was set here? Because I've been interested in some of the commentary out there on the approach that we should take here in Scotland, and we should look at what's happening in other jurisdictions to help to inform our future model of the female custodial estate. And from the International Symposium, and also from the review, the literature review that we've also conducted as well in this area, I have been struck by the sheer lack of alternative models out there to inform the approach that we take here in Scotland. So, you know, Colin McConnell's correct. We are in a situation here where we are leading from the front in the different approach that we are planning to take here. The intention is that the core aspect of our female custodial estate will be the national unit and the five community units, along with the facility we presently have at Grampian. What I've said on a number of occasions is that the custodial environment doesn't sit in isolation. It sits alongside the other measures that we will have to take forward, and that is about making sure that we have less women find themselves in remand, that we have to look at the use of short sentences, where women are more likely to experience a short sentence than a male, that it has to sit alongside the reform that we're taking forward within community criminal justice provision as well. And all of those measures collectively can help to reduce the demand that we actually have, we require from our custodial estate. As that demand starts to recede and decline, then we're then in a position where we can start to turn off some of the provision that we have in Edinburgh and elsewhere. But what I'm not in a position to be able to do, I can't turn off the demand like a tap. I saw this in the press on a number of occasions. People keep saying you need to turn off the tap. If it were that easy, I suspect many of my predecessors would have turned off the tap. But what I am determined to try and do is to stop the door revolving around this particular debate and to start putting in place things that will start to turn the tap in the right direction.
So taps, revolving doors.
So
I think I'm following the narrative.
I was reading a bit in the press this morning. It's about, you know, again, we need to turn off the tap. And if it were only that simple. So the point I'm making is that as we take forward these other measures that can help to reduce the demand in our custodial estate for women, then we can start to close them down or no longer use them for as part of the female custodial estate. And the objective then is to have that core female custodial estate as we've set out as an ambition. Now, there are significant risks attached to that because if you just drop it down to the core right from the very start, you could be in a situation where potentially you end up with overcrowding in some facilities because you haven't got the balance right. So the custodial aspect is only one element of the jigsaw. All of the other elements can help us to achieve what is the ultimate objective, and that is to reduce our female prison population and to then have a custodial environment which is reflective of that. And that would be the core that we've already set out as being our plan. So there are, you know, I don't underestimate the challenges there are in getting to that particular point. But I believe it's very ambitious, and given our look internationally at the evidence out there, I'm very confident that it is very ambitious compared to what's happened in other jurisdictions.
Thank you. Elaine, you were going to ask something, then John and then Roderick.
Thanks, Convener. Probably relates a bit to this tap, actually.
I'm just counting your metaphors, Minister. You're going in my columns even as we write.
That's really about mental health support, both for people who have offended or are either in prison or on release, or indeed the support, which is a pilot project in Glasgow, or was a pilot project for 6 months in the Greater Glasgow area, regarding sort of out-of-hours access to community psychiatric nurses for police officers, which seems to have been quite successful in terms of not 96% of the people referred not actually requiring any further intervention. So maybe if you can expand on those particular projects, but also what are the implications if that's rolled out? What are actually the implications for the health service? Because clearly, you know, that's 234 individuals who were referred in the Greater Glasgow project. That across the country could be a significant number of people and require additional mental health professionals within the health service to be able to give the police and indeed offenders the requisite amount of support.
I think this is a very important issue, which I think underscores the need for better partnership working. You'll be aware that we had the ministerial group looking at the reintegration of prisoners back into the community, and a key part of that was about looking at how we can make sure the different component parts of government and public service are operating in a much more coordinated way, from health through to housing. and the prison service. And there was a whole range of recommendations that came from that, which are now being taken forward by the different departments. Colin's got a lead in some of these areas. 18 different recommendations in that particular report when we published it last year, all of which have been taken forward in order to address some aspects of the joined up working. But there's the other side of it, and that is about those individuals who end up within our criminal justice system when, in fact, they are more in need of health support and health service supports. So the pilot, which was run in Glasgow, which you mentioned, was proved to be very successful. Very successful on the basis that allowed the police, where they identified an individual who was in distress or in difficulty, and they suspected there was an underlying mental health issue, they were able to contact the out-of-hours service in order to check whether they had any record of this individual or knew of them, and to get advice. In effect, we're doing a triage of that particular person's circumstances at that time based on the information we're being provided by the police. It wasn't a new resource. It was actually just a different way of working. It was the out-of-hours mental health team have always been there. What it was about making the link between the police and that particular service, and with the out-of-hours service and the police. So what we've now been doing is taking forward the learning from that. There was an event last year which was hosted at Tilly Allen, looking at the experience in Glasgow. And what's now happening is that there's a number of health board areas are now working with local police commands and looking at how they can then deliver that type of approach here, or that approach within their own particular health board area. So,
if you can, which health board areas? I think because the question was rolling it out, so it'd be helpful to know where this is being expanded. It seems a really sensible idea.
So there's work being taken forward in Lothian at the present moment as well. I can get more details on the other board areas where there's work being taken forward in this. But this is exactly the type of thing which we can find individuals who end up in our criminal justice system when in the end the criminal justice system wasn't the place it should have been in the first place. And the statistics show firsthand the real difference that that it can make. Just one wee bit of anecdote. I had a meeting. I was out with the British Transport Police a number of months ago, and some of the officers at Central Station Glasgow tell me that they now have a specific phone which is purely for this purpose, so that they can a mobile phone in their car, which is just so that they can call the out-of-hours mental health service. And officers were giving me a very good example of where they found that someone near the railway lines appeared to be in distress, didn't have any background in the individual, but they got their details, they were able to contact the out-of-hours mental health service. They had knowledge of them. The arrangement was the police then took them to their home, and the out-of-hours mental health team knew that they had family support there who'd be able to assist them, and that resolved the issue. In the past, there would have been a situation where that person had been taken to accident emergency or potentially taken into custody, which avoided all of that. So the work that Police Scotland are now taking forward on a national level is to try and help to make sure that other health board areas are making sure that their out-of-hours mental health teams are responding to the police when these issues are arising. So it was largely a change in work practice rather than actually being any big new project that required additional funding.
Now that seems extremely sensible, so it would be very helpful if we had details about how far this is being progressed with other health boards, and if any are being tardy. Not meaning to be tardy, but you know, where it's just a change in work practices. It seems extremely sensible. As so many of us know that people end up in custody or in police stations who have mental health problems, whether they're permanent or a temporary state. So it would be very useful for the committee to know about other health boards. I think we'd all want that. Yes? Thank you.
The CPN service obviously operates out of hours anyway, because a lot of people who have mental health problems need support.
So. Integrating with the police.
I wondered whether in the longer term there would be... Are you anticipating there might be a requirements for some transfer of resource from criminal justice to the mental health services in order to for additional support?
Well, I think actually if you look at the vast majority of their experience in Glasgow, a lot of it didn't require any specialist response. It was they didn't have to be admitted to hospital or to be taken into custody. So I'm not entirely sure there is a need here for resource transfer. You know, arguably, you know, you would expect this from the Justice Secretary. A lot of this has caused a lot of cost in our criminal justice system over the years. And, you know, when I was the Public Health Minister, one of the areas where I sought to try and give focus to was the need for our health service to be much more effective in dealing with individuals who present in distress. People who present with an obvious mental health issue, but individuals who present in distress, our system is not good at responding to them. And if you look at the track record of many individuals who sadly go on to commit suicide, their contact with their health service and also aspects of our criminal justice system can be quite extensive over an extended period of time as well. And the question is, well, why are we not picking up those warning signs? Why are we not intervening at an earlier stage? And when individuals, by and large, and I don't say this for, you know, because people are just simply not interested, but by and large, when someone in distress presents at an A&E department, they will say, well, actually, you don't have a mental health issue as far as we're concerned. Look, just go on, and they may make a referral on to social work, but the link between that won't really be followed up. You know, I don't think it's about transferring resource from one area to another. I think it's more about trying to make sure that the gaps between some of these services are closed down and that they link up much more effectively. So if we have an out-of-hours mental health team who are available to be able to advise the police when they have someone before them that this person is known to them, actually they're not at risk, or take them home because we know they've got support there, or there's someone who needs to be admitted to hospital. When you've got someone on the line who can give you that type of clinical advice, that makes a big difference to the police. And it reduces the need for someone to be brought into to custody, and all of the resource that's then tied up with someone coming into custody as well. So it's not about transferring resource. It's just about, I think, making better use of the resource that we've got at the present time to be much more effective in addressing the needs of these individuals.
I'll move on. John, followed by Roderick. John, please.
Thank you. Part of what... very detailed response, Cabinet Secretary, thank you for that, particularly this section in healthcare, and that's been touched on. I don't know if this is a question more directed to Mr McConnell yourself, but with regard to the National Prisoner Healthcare Network, and in particular the female offender health work streams, is there more you can say about the offender through care work stream, please?
Is there any particular aspect, Mr Finney, that you're interested in?
Well, I'm presuming links are better with the change that took place with NHS and the Scottish Prison Service, but are there still challenges connected with people securing a GP, for instance, when they are released from prison? Is that part of how the...
I think indeed that is still a challenge. We shouldn't try and hide away from that. I mean, there's a number of disconnections that occur, as you know, when people move into custody, hence our issue about people moving into custody needlessly or for short periods of time. That's another discussion. But yes, I mean, there are still particular challenges to be overcome. But I think the integration of, you know, as the Cabinet Secretary has been talking about, these two big national organisations working together, I think undoubtedly there are significant improvements. And we're seeing... Again, to I think praise where praise is due for healthcare colleagues, I think we're seeing significant improvements generally across the service. I think there are some hot spots still, and the Chief Inspector has commented on them as he's been conducting inspection reviews of prisons. But no doubt things are generally improving, but there are particular issues linking up with GPs or linking up with particular services that have been connected whilst in the custodial space, moving back into the community, making sure that that consistency of availability is still a challenge for us.
I spent some time with through care officers in Berlin a couple of months ago with Ian Whitehead, the governor there, and I was struck by the real potential that can come from the greater use of through care officers within our prison system. These two particular individuals had extended careers within the prison service, 20 plus year service, and they were absolutely glowing about how they enjoyed working as a through care officer, the link between the prison and into the community and supporting individuals and moving back into the community. But one of the things that they found most dispiriting was the number of barriers that individuals can face when they do move back into the community. One of the very simple ones which they face is being able to apply for benefit, because many of the benefits have gone to being online, and some of them will not provide you with a benefit if you have no fixed abode. Some of them can't get a fixed abode until they are liberated from prison. So you then have them that they can't get the accommodation because they don't have the benefit to pay for the accommodation, and that they then find themselves in difficulty. And I was struck by, and you know, what the through care officers can do is help them and register them with a GP, and helping to get them to that first appointment, encouraging them to do so. But what I was particularly encouraged by was the real enthusiasm that there was amongst some of the prison officers who were involved in this area of work. And I think the potential in that area of prison staff being engaged much more beyond the walls of the prison and helping to address these issues, I think gives us a really good opportunity going forward in the future. But there also needs to be some changes in the system beyond that of healthcare in order to remove some of the barriers which at times can actually encourage people to fail rather than actually helping to support to reintegrate them back into the community.
Thank you. Can I ask about another work stream?
Can I just ask, and we've had this before at the committee about the permeable walls, as it were, the porous walls of the prison, which seems again like a very practical and sensible idea, but... Pardon?
Not too porous, hopefully.
No, it's my metaphor I get to use this one. But the point I was going to make is that do all prison officers now in training to become prison officers, is this part of the training that's done? I mean, you talked about these very established ones who do form a relationship with the prisoners and you know, support them and so on. But and they're not turnkeys and so on. They're actually more, you know, that's an old, long-gone expression. So can you just tell me, Mr. McConnell, if there's anything in the training now about it, that as we're moving in this direction?
I mean, again, thanks very much for giving me the opportunity to, again, assure the committee and you particularly, convener, that that is a significant element of basic prison officer training. And again, if I may blow our own trumpet here in terms of what Scotland is doing on that very issue, learning from all the work that Professor McNeill is leading on in terms of desistance theory and desistance thinking. Again, with the government support, Scottish Prison Service is actively developing the future training and qualification of prison officers in Scotland. And again, very much internationally leading the way on that. And we've engaged with Scottish universities and other international sector experts in terms of the future training and qualification of people working in prisons in the future. And again, linked to what the Cabinet Secretary was saying, the future vision will be that this will not be a workforce that's simply constrained to working with people in custody, but will become truly justice professionals that work across and through the justice system. And all the issues you've just raised are very much at the core of that.
I just thought it was useful following that up.
Thank you. I was delighted to see one of the work streams related to brain injury. The committee received a fascinating presentation about the high incidence of brain injury among prisoners, which was considerably more. Now, clearly, there's a limit to how you can prevent.
We've kind of moved off women offenders and
well,
that particular...
Well, you may feel that, convener. However, I'm reading from the report that we got from the...
Go for it then.
Yeah, you,
I'm sick corrected. Just making sure we keep to the brief, okay?
Absolutely. Paragraph 52. And the higher incidence among prisoners, clearly we can't prevent the incidence that someone sustains an injury. It may be about detection. Can you explain more about what that work stream involves, please?
Yeah, sure. It's really about understanding much more of the circumstances about why people get into trouble in the first place and come into contact with justice services, the justice system. And if I may say so, it's a sort of counterpoint. This may seem a bit obvious to say, but it's a counterpoint to the often peddled view that, you know, folk that get into trouble are just simply bad. there's a whole range of drivers and reasons why people sometimes, unconscious to themselves, indulge in behaviours that ultimately get them into contact with the justice system. And this stream of work is about helping us to understand with other professional organisations and professional people how we can work more intelligently together to keep people out of the justice system in the first place, if and when that's appropriate. But when they do come into our contact, to understand more appropriately what our responses should be in terms of engaging with them, both from a medical and from a relationship point of view, in order to make their recovery, and we would hope, reduced or no reoffending in the future. So that's really the core of the work stream.
I think there was a suggestion a lot of these injuries hadn't necessarily been recorded at the time, and it was research that subsequently discovered that people had sustained significant head injuries that should have resulted in brain damage. What's been done about, or what can be done about, the earlier, if you like, recording of these?
I think some of that moves out of necessarily just the justice system. But I think the fact that we do have a core work stream, you've just touched on it, Mr. Finney, is about raising awareness of the issue. And I go back to the point that I made right at the outset. Some of this is about debunking myths and stereotypes. And what's very clear is that there's no homogenous thing as an offender. There are many, many reasons and causes as to why people have the behaviours that they have, and some of those behaviours lead them into the justice system. And I think raising awareness, getting a better understanding of what the issues are and why they've come around, and then how to positively respond to them, that's the key to turning these things around.
Okay, thanks very much.
Thank you, John. I apologise. Yes, paragraph 52, absolutely right. Roderick, and then Christian, please.
Morning, Cabinet Secretary. Could I just pick up some of the themes that were being discussed a few minutes ago in relation to through care? But I wanted to refer to the evaluation report of the 16 projects, which was published last year. In the conclusions, 11.4 says the evaluation identified potential gaps in service provision that may be considered in future initiatives. Opportunities include developing more purposeful or rewarding activities for women at an earlier stage and forging women's links in the community, helping women to cope with the loss of children into care and support them in regaining or maintaining custody where appropriate, and support for women leaving short-term prison sentences through care, which we were talking about earlier. Obviously, in the annex to your report, you talk about the importance of mentoring, but given that comment, is there anything further you can add to the themes that that were in that conclusion, in particular in relation to women?
Well, what has happened since the evaluation report was published is that we've been working with those different organisations and service providers to look at how we can build on what the evaluation has highlighted for them, where there can be further improvements, and how they can look at adapting their practices. And that's a piece of ongoing work. And we also, as you may be aware, last year provided some ongoing financial support to some of these organisations to allow them to continue to develop their services and to take their services forward over the last year. So rather than it being, I think this is always, you know, if you look back at the Commission's report, the objective was not to try and create some sort of centralised process of this is how you must do it at a local level and how it has to be delivered. What it was about trying to help to support those services at a local level to redesign and to reconfigure themselves in a way that achieves better outcomes. And the evaluation report was to help to support in achieving that. And the work that's been ongoing since then is focusing around where there's been issues highlighted where further improvements could be made or changes and adaptations to the services can be made in order to achieve better outcomes. So the evaluation report wasn't the end in the process. It was an opportunity to take a look at those services at that particular point and to look at where further improvements could be made.
Okay, and for women with children in particular, the loss of children into care and help to regain custody, any specific thoughts or initiatives that might tackle that particular issue?
Well, we're into that's a very big area that doesn't confine itself just to those projects in any shape or fashion. Part of that goes to the very heart of looking at what's the most effective way, what does the evidence base tell us is the most effective way in reducing the risk of someone committing offences again in the future. Well, we know that one of the things that can result in people committing offences again is that if they are separated from their family, if they lose their housing, if they lose their job, all of these factors that can then actually create the potential for individuals to commit further offences again in the future. And part of the approach through some of these services, also the redesign we're looking to make within the custodial estate, the additional investment we're putting into alternatives to custody, are all about trying to make sure we take a much more evidence-based approach to how we deal with individuals who have committed offences. And that involves looking at our community disposals much more effective in helping to address their offending behaviour, while at the same time maintaining their housing situation, their family contacts, and also maintaining employment if they are in employment. All of these various parts of the jigsaw all have to come together in order to deal with the very types of issues that you've highlighted around separation from family, and in particular the impact that can have on children, because evidence also shows us that children who experience the type of trauma of a parent being in custody are at greater risk of potentially ending up in custody at some point in their own later life. So how can we help to address some of that? Part of that is, like, for example, the mentoring service that we have that we're delivering through Shine and the work that they're taking forward across the whole of the country to help to provide role models for individuals who are either coming out of custody, are in remand, or on remand in the are in the community, in a community disposal. So all of these different elements have a part to play. And the community custodial units, a key part of them is, and having them on a regional basis, is to help to support maintaining those family links while someone may be within the custodial environment, something which we know has been lacking with the largely centralised approach that we've taken with a single female prison in Scotland.
I could move on, if I may. You talked earlier about the Pathfinder projects. Obviously, we've also had a consultation presumption against short sentences, which closed in December. Have you any initial thoughts on that consultation, and indeed the implications, particularly for women?
Well, that the consultation closed in the middle of December last year. We are in the process of collating all of the submissions that we received to that consultation. There were in total 63 submissions to the consultation. We are still joined together that data and that information, and once I've had an opportunity to then consider what the findings are from the consultation, we'll then be in a position where we can take a view on what we think should be any change to the presumption against. I think the other part that's important to keep in mind here is that the presumption against short sentences may not have a big impact on the overall number of individuals we have in our prison system, because it will affect both females and males. What it will certainly do, if it is increased, is it will help to address the churn of those who get short sentences. The vast majority of individuals within our custodial estate get a sentence of 2 years or more. If the presumption was to be increased, then it will help to reduce the churn of those who get those short sort of 6 month type sentences, and the level of resource that takes up within our prison system, which will free up that resource to be used much more effectively. So it may not, it won't have a big impact on the global number within our prison system, but it certainly will have a significant impact on the churn that we have of short-term prison sentences. And the range of that impact will be dependent upon the threshold at which we set the presumption.
Yeah, specifically for women, though, it could have a differential impact on women as opposed to men?
Potentially, yes, because women are more likely to get short prison sentences. Yeah. So potentially, yes. But as I say, it will be largely around that churn of short-term prisoners rather than the overall global number.
Yeah. Are you able to indicate when the analysis of the consultation response will be published?
It's at a fairly advanced stage. I would hope in the coming weeks I'll see the outcome from the actual analysis, and then we'll then have to consider what approach we then want to take as a government in any changes that we want to take forward in the presumption against. Because it covered two areas. One was, or two aspects to it. One was that should we increase the presumption from 3 months? And if so, what should we increase it to? And the other aspect is that do you think we should actually take a radically different approach to dealing with short-term sentences? So we have to look at both aspects of what the feedback has been in the consultation. Well, I noticed that the Herald have got a front page splash on some of the views that have been expressed in the consultation.
Thank you.
Do read your newspapers.
Yeah.
I was going to just ask about that. You said, you know, the resources that are wasted, and I'm making the presumption, I think, hopefully correctly, that those resources would go into the non-custodial element of, you know, people who are either electronically monitored or being supported out with, that we move away from that. Can you say, you know, when if and when that takes place, the presumption against these short sentences, how that the resources would be able to move in time, how, you know, the timeline for the resources to move from the custodial part of the justice system to the monitoring within the community, community service and so on. That's a tricky one to do.
We're back to the tap here.
So sometimes you need a tap.
I'll bring in Colin, because Colin McConnell will be able to give you a bit more of an insight into the practical demand that the churn of short-term prisoners can have on the prison system.
Please stop this in the cabinet. Like, we know the practical demand, and we know the administration and how there's a revolving door. I'm interested in the transfer of those resources in terms of, I think bucks are being passed here.
A couple of things. I just wanted to, from the SPS's point of view, to give them the opportunity just to explain how. But if you have that knowledge, that's fine. If you look at what we've done in the last 2 years, we've transferred a modest amount of resource from the prison service into the community. Over the last 2 years, it's been £3 million. We've identified in the forthcoming financial year what will be a resource transfer going from the prison service into community justice provision and into alternatives to custody of what will cumulatively come to about £5.5 million. So we are gradually making that shift. But as I say, what we've also got to recognise is that there's still a considerable level of demand in the prison system as well. So we are starting to try and make that shift. As if we increase the presumption against, and that saves a marked level of resource within the prison service that can then be better utilised for supporting areas such as community disposals, then we can look at trying to do that. But you're right. The challenge here is that if you reduce the prison population to community disposals, that money isn't released until that reduction has taken place. But these individuals have to be somewhere else receiving those custodial, those alternatives to custody. That's why we're attempting just now to start some of that shift so that £5.5 million that we're putting into alternatives and to community justice provision this year, which is alongside over £100 million that we put in. It's a protected budget that we have in community criminal justice social work budgets. We're trying to start moving that shift where we can, while trying to balance up the demand that there is still within the prison service. And to achieve that, while we're in the present financial climate where budgets are reducing overall. So it's not only difficult to do it at any time, it is made even more difficult to do in the present financial climate. But we are making that process, we're starting that process, and in, as I say, in the forthcoming financial year, we are moving a bigger chunk of money from the prison service into the community setting than has ever happened before, while trying to maintain the needs of what the prison service need in meeting their...
I was asked that was in the context of women prisoners, many of whom I think the committee would agree are not, shouldn't be in custody in the first place, and that they need a huge amount of support across housing, across medical services, across all kinds of things for a considerable period of time if they're not in custody. And it was just to ensure that, you know, laudable though it may be at the end of the day to stop short prison sentences, not just for women, but say for women, then you have to have resources in place, or they're very vulnerable.
Yeah, the other point that's worth keeping in mind here, and the Commission's report recognised this, is that dealing with some of these issues is not all about new money. Sometimes it's about changing work practices and the approaches.
That's what
Eilish Angelini's report recognised, is that this is not all about new money. This is actually about using existing resources much more effectively in order to address offending behaviour and in providing alternatives. And I think there's still work to be done in helping to make sure we get that. And part of trying to help to support achieving that is through the Community Justice Bill and reconfiguring the way in which community criminal justice provision is delivered at a local level with a level of national oversight to try and get some consistency in how it's being applied across the country.
But some funding will be required. Yes, you can improve integration of services, but I think some funding will be required, will it not?
And that's exactly what we've started this year, as I've outlined to you.
I just thought I'd rattle that one through. Christian. Are you cold, Christian?
It is.
I think this is revenge because we complained about a window being open last week. I don't know if other committee members are cold. Perhaps it's just a few of us. I agree with you. Temperature is low. I've put that on the record.
I was not making a complaint. I was only making a statement. Kevin Secretary, good morning. You wrote to us and you said that when the Commission on Women Offenders was established in 2012, the female prison population has steadily risen for more than 10 years. And you added that the recent statistic say that the female prison population has reduced. But I remember you coming in front of this committee and saying that you had another great success is young people were less and less coming into our prison system. To what extent that success of young people not going into the prison excess is affecting these figures?
I suspect it's probably still too early to say. Because the reduction we've had in, you mean in our young offenders population, the reduction, the very marked reduction we've had in our youth offending population is such that it may take a couple of years for us to see how that feeds into the adult population. So over the last couple of years, we've saw the number of young offenders overall reduce. I would also anticipate that feeding into the adult prison population, but it may be a few years. As I say, I'd be very hesitant to start banding too many figures around on that will result in X reduction in our adult prison population, male or female, until we move on in a few years' time, because it's only been in the last couple of years that we've saw this marked reduction in our young offenders. But over the last 3 years, when it comes to women young offenders, in total, in 2013-14, there were 566, and the figure to date for 2015-16 is 445 over the course of the year so far. So that's a clear reduction that's taking place there. But as I say, I'd be very hesitant at this stage, though, just to set out how that may feed into the adult population. I would expect it to, but what that will look like, it's too early to say.
It's quite interesting to find out, because the Commission on Women Offenders back in 2012 was saying that there were a population of women who were decreasing. It was one under the age of 21. They were already decreasing at that time. But what we found is that the women offenders over the age of 30, that prison population was increasing. is VAT population decreasing now?
I can, globally, the figure since 2011, the female prison population we have in Scotland has declined by just over 6.5%. It's now down to an average of around 430. But within those different age bands, I don't know whether if Colin has more detail on that, but if not, we can certainly check to see if we can get some more detail on the different age groupings.
Yeah, I mean, I'm calling from memory here, but I think some of the detail that was produced by Justice Analytics, I think generally the given trend is that peak offending, I think regardless of the gender, is moving to the right. So peak offending is getting older. And what we see in custody, not just because of that, but because of longer sentences for some particular offending types, then the custodial population itself is tending to get older. Whether you can extrapolate much, as the Cabinet Secretary has said, from some of the early data we have on trends for youngsters, I think it's too early at this stage to try and make those connections.
It'd be good to understand, just to make sure that population of women over the age of 30 are very much affected by, you know, by the great work that you've done. We're not talking only about young offenders, but we're talking about the women of all ages. That would be important, I think.
Well, I can certainly give you that assurance. Yes.
Do you want to say something, Cabinet Secretary? We can stop right there. Thank you very much. Okay, that's quite a long session, but a worthwhile one, because it's a very important issue and progress has been made, but I know that we want to see more progress made. Can I thank Mr. McConnell and Ms. Morgan for attending? Cabinet Secretary is staying for items 3 and 4, so I'll just suspend for a couple of minutes to allow officials to change over, please. On to item 3 in the agenda. It's consideration of the first of 3 affirmative instruments, the Draft Rehabilitation of Offenders Act 1974, Exclusions and Exceptions, Scotland Amendment No. 2, Order 2016. I thank the Cabinet Secretary for staying with this item, and I welcome the meeting other Scottish Government officials, Keith Main, Safer Communities Division, and Carla McCloy-Stevens, Director for Legal Services. Can I remind everyone present, as you already know, the officials can take part in this item, but obviously under the direction of the Cabinet Secretary, I would suggest, because this is an evidence session. I invite the Cabinet Secretary, if he wishes, to make a brief opening statement.
Thank you, Convener. The Rehabilitation of Offenders Act 1974 allows individuals whose convictions are spent to legally say that they have not been convicted of a crime. The aim is to help rehabilitate offenders by not making their past mistakes affect the rest of their lives if they have been on the right side of the law for some time. This means that a person who has a spent conviction does not generally have to disclose it and is protected from being prejudiced by that conviction or failure to disclose it. There are, however, exclusions and exceptions to this protection. These are set out in the Rehabilitation of Offenders Act 1974, Exclusions and Exceptions, Scotland Order 2013. In particular, the 2013 order removes the protection in cases where a person is applying for a firearm or shotgun certificate. This permits the Chief Constable to elicit and consider information about spent convictions when assessing a person's suitability to hold such a certificate. The draft order before the committee today aims to add airgun licensing to the exclusion and exception in the 2013 order, bringing airgun applications into line with those of other types of guns. I believe this is necessary to protect public safety and prevent air weapons falling into the wrong hands. In passing the bill for the Air Weapons and Licensing Scotland Act 2015, the Parliament agreed with the Scottish Government that air guns are potentially lethal weapons which should be subject to greater control. This order helps us to achieve that greater control by requiring a person to disclose all spent and unspent convictions and allowing the Chief Constable to take that information into account when deciding whether or not to grant an air weapons certificate or permit. It is worth emphasising that the existence of a past conviction does not necessarily mean that an application will be refused. The Chief Constable will take all of the circumstances into account before deciding on each case. In addition, the Chief Constable's reliance on spent convictions information in any particular case must be justifiable and compatible with convention rights, and any refusal to grant an application is appealable to the Sheriff.
That's very helpful. Any questions? Just to clarify, it isn't that there have been previous incidents with air rifles or air guns. It can be any other kind of thing. I see animal cruelty or something would be an issue. So it's just to clarify that that is the case. It could be disturbances of all kinds, perhaps aggressive behaviour, assaults and so on. So it's not just connected to possession of weapons.
No, it's not. It's any spent convictions.
Yes. That's useful. I then move on to no other questions from committee members. I want to item 4, the formal debate to approve the instrument. I invite the Cabinet Secretary to move motion S4M15427. The Justice Committee recommends that the Draft Rehabilitation of Offenders Act 1974 Exclusions and Exceptions Scotland Amendment No. 2 Order 2016 be approved.
Moved.
Thank you very much. Do members wish to speak in the debate? I take it there's nothing to respond to. Put the question to the committee. The question is that motion S4M15427 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you very much. That's that. So what we do is, thank you, Cabinet Secretary, and your officials for attending. I'll suspend briefly to allow the next set of witnesses to come in to item 5. Move on to item 5. It's the second affirmative instrument today, the Draft Courts Reform Scotland Act 2014, Consequential Provisions Order 2016. Welcome to meeting Paul Wheelhouse, Minister for Community Safety and Legal Affairs, and the government officials Walter Drummond Murray, Civil Law and Legal System Division, and Greg Walker, Director for Legal Services of the Scottish Government. This is an evidence session. I don't need to say the usual stuff because you know all about it, so I'll invite the Minister, if he wishes, to make a brief opening statement.
I'm happy to waive that, convener.
Right. Are there any questions on this instrument whatsoever? Roderick.
Convener, just for good order, are you able to advise how many stipendiary magistrates effectively are going to be abolished? How many are there?
I will check with my colleagues, but I believe there's two, but yeah. If I can just confirm that.
There's two full-timers and 7 part-timers who will be transferring to be summary sheriffs on the 1st of April.
Thank you.
They're not going, they're becoming something else.
Yes.
They'll be happy to know that. Right, that's the evidence session over. I now move to item 6 in the agenda, which is the formal debate and the motion to approve the instrument. I invite the Minister to move motion S4M15423.
Sorry, convener.
Don't cut my part. It's not allowed. That the Justice Committee recommends the Draft Courts Reform Scotland Act 2014 Consequential Provisions Order 2016 be approved.
Formally moved.
I take it no member wishes to speak in this debate, and you don't wish to respond, Minister. Can I put the question to the committee? The question is that motion S4M15423 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you very much. I suspend briefly to allow the officials to change over. And now we want item 7. It's consideration of a third affirmative instrument, the Draft Advice and Assistance in Civil Legal Aid, Financial Conditions and Contributions, Scotland Amendment Regulations 2016. We have before us the Minister still, and we have Denise Swanson, Civil Law and Legal Systems Division, and Alistair Smith, Directorate of Legal Services, Scottish Government. This is, again, an evidence session. Do you want to make an opening statement, Minister?
I'm happy to waive that, Convener.
Questions from members? Margaret and Roderick.
I wonder if, Minister, you could comment on the concerns raised by the Law Society, not while supportive of the instrument itself, on the fundamental difficulties regarding payment mechanism for police station work.
Well, certainly I recognise this is an issue that has been a subject of debate for some time. People being questioned at police station will obviously no longer have to consider costs when accessing legal advice. And the Law Society, I understand, is supportive of the removal of police station contributions. And we think it is a positive step in reducing bureaucracy also for solicitors. And they will no longer have to assess and collect contributions for this work. We believe there is potential for significant efficiencies and simplification of the current system of legal aid to deliver savings, while also maintaining, as I've said to the committee previously, a high priority is to maintain the wide access to legal aid for both criminal and civil cases. And we're committed to working with the legal profession, Law Society and other stakeholders to deliver these efficiencies. And obviously it's an issue that's been flagged up with the Justice Board as well, as an area to try and work together with the practitioners and also policy colleagues to try and ensure we have as efficient a system as possible. I know there have been some concerns raised about individual fee rates and so forth. The Law Society's contribution is also focused on the contributions element as well, and contracting as well. So these are all issues that we are discussing with the Law Society as to how we take forward wider reform of the legal aid system, but that hopefully this single measure that we're dealing with today will simplify the process for solicitors, advocates and solicitor advocates in terms of providing advice to their clients and make life easier for their clients as well.
Okay. Roderick.
Okay, Convener, perhaps I ought for good order to refer to my register of interest as a member of the Faculty of Advocates. The Law Society in their paper talk about moving to a system of block fees. Could you comment, Minister, on the implications of that?
But certainly also the comments that have been made by the Law Society in their response will be taken into consideration as part of the implementation of the Criminal Justice Bill and a wider review of criminal legal assistance, which is something that we've committed to doing. And as part of a review of the legal aid system to achieve a simpler and more efficient system, we have asked the Scottish Legal Aid Board to look at the management and administration of court duty schemes, including fee structures and the required standards of service. As in any area of legal work, legal aid work, we will work with the Law Society of Scotland and Justice Partners to ensure the system fairly rewards the work required in the round. And I stress that, and that there's a lot of focus on individual elements of the legal aid fees, but we're looking at the overall cost and payment for taking forward a case on behalf of a client. And while we want to incentivise practices that promote the best interests of clients and the effective operation of the wider justice system as well, so we've already made it clear to the Law Society that we plan to work with them and the Scottish Legal Aid Board to review legal aid provisions as a whole in order to achieve a simpler and hopefully more efficient system. I know that's the theory, at least. It's obviously difficult to deliver in practice, but we want to manage expenditure effectively while maintaining access to justice and ensuring Scotland has a sustainable legal aid system. So the issue of block fees will certainly be something that will feature within that discussion, because clearly there are advantages from a simplicity point of view, from the point of view of the legal advisor, cutting down the bureaucracy, the need to specify individual time commitments that have been used on behalf of their client, but also, you know, it's something we need to have as much evidence as possible to inform that discussion about what appropriate block fee would be in that situation. I wonder, though, Convener, if I may just bring in Denise at this point to discuss the level of discussion that have happened with the Law Society on the issue of block fees.
Thank you. Yes, the Law Society and practitioners are broadly supportive of block fees, and in the Law Society's paper there has been some mention of that. And the work that's underway at the moment is to try and look at the, we're focusing on criminal initially, is to look at the various elements of work that a solicitor might do to support a client in any aspect of criminal procedure. That's right from the police station right through to the Sheriff Appeal Court. And so looking at how that might be structured, I think it's important to say, though, that we would, at the moment, in our block fee arrangements, there's also provision for exceptional case status. So if there are exceptional cases that fall out with the normal routine work that a solicitor might do, then there is a route to apply for additional remuneration to address the additional work. So we're trying to get a balance between the block fees and, as Mr. Wheelhouse has said, the simplicity and reducing bureaucracy, but ensuring that there is capacity within the system to deal with exceptional and out of norm circumstances.
Thank you.
That's fine. I have no other questions. I'm going to move on to item 8, the formal debate on the motion to approve the instrument. I invite the Minister to move motion S4M15426 that the Justice Committee recommends the draft advice and assistance in civil legal aid, financial conditions and contributions Scotland Amendment Regulations 2016 be approved.
Formally moved, Camilla.
I take it nobody wishes to speak in the debate, nobody wishes to sum up. So I put the question that motion S4M15426 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
As members are aware, we're required to report on all affirmative instruments. Are the members content to delegate authority to me to sign off the report on the three instruments we consider today? Thank you very much. That concludes the meeting. Our next, which we already dealt with, item 9. The next meeting will be the 23rd of February, and I close the meeting. Thank you.